should understand that the audience of Екатерина is rather young. Mm-hmm. Because I'm working in different shows which are about politics and so on.
Yeah.
And usually it's the audience is older than 40 and 50 and so on. Mm-hmm. And the audience of Екатерина is much younger. It starts at 2025.
Oh, okay.
And that's great because this audience is very is always very included, you know. Mm-hmm. They are always making memes and so on after every programs
really?
In Instagram, in TikTok,
okay.
everywhere, a lot of different memes about this program, about us and so on. Mm. Yeah.
How much do you love watching your own show?
I never watch my own videos. So this is it. This is, I think, the last episode.
Mm-hmm.
We actually call it seasons and episodes, like in a TV show.
Okay, yes, okay, that's it. What does it say?
It says...
It's very stupid words. In Russian it sounds like it was written not in Russian.
Yes, it really? Sounds like it was created by a neural, I don't know, net, by some artificial intellect and not a very good intellect either. Mm-hmm.
This message or material created or broadcasted by...
And or.
And or broadcasted by... foreign
Public information
service
mm-hmm. yes, acting acting the functions of a foreign agent and or a Russian legal body
mm-hmm.
acting the functions of a foreign agent. What does it mean? It's hard to me to understand.
Okay.
It's a jumble of words. In Russian, agent is not the same as agent in English. Agent is a spy.
Can you maybe tell me about the first March, about how your radio station got shut down?
The radio station was closed right during our program, and that was the first time when the chief editor of the radio station gave us 2 hours on air, because it was an emergency situation and we were told that from now on, every Tuesday you have not 1 hour, but two. So I kind of prepared for this extraordinary lengthy program, and we started, said hello, and then in the studio with us was the audio operator, and he suddenly started telling that we are going out of air. And it was moving, as far as I remember, from east to west. And he said, now Ufa doesn't hear us, now Kazan doesn't hear us, now Samara is off. And then it came to Moscow. And in like, I don't know, 10 minutes, it was all off. But since we were on air, not just on radio, but also on YouTube as a stream, so we, of course, kept on. And we had those 2 hours. We said what we needed to say, but that was the last time.
It was written, no war behind us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I should say that it was like this, but not exactly like this, because really our operator, audio operator, he said that we are not on air. But I was working as a deputy of editor-in-chief in the regional politics of our radio station. So that's why I knew how it works. So when he said we are not on air, I understood that they switched off us from Moscow radio antenna. But we still had St. Petersburg, Kazan, Ufa,
so it was
and so
way
on.
Around.
Yeah,
okay.
And then our listeners who were listening the radio, they were writing from different cities or by SMS that, oh, they just switched off you in Kazan.
Mm-hmm.
And then after 20 minutes, and there were some regions which were listening till the end, till the last 10 minutes, something like that. So it was not in 1 minute, but it was, yeah. And then we decided to work on YouTube, and 2 days or 3 days after that, we were working on YouTube. So our program is on Tuesday, and our YouTube was closed on Friday.
Oh, okay. And what did you think in that situation? Because, of course, you were thinking that maybe that could happen someday, but I don't know. I could guess that you would be still surprised in that moment.
Well, it's one thing to anticipate, another to actually experience. Yeah. So, of course, it gives you a kind of, I can't say it gives you a shock, but it gives you a feeling of being present at a historical event. Mm. I remember how we went out of the studio to the so-called guest room, and the chief editor, Alexei Venediktov, was there, and people from Novaya Gazeta, who were at that very moment doing a report, a story about Echo of Moscow, and they made a picture of me, so they made photos of all of us, and that did feel like a historical drama. Which in fact it was. Then I remember Venediktov told me that we are going on YouTube, but of course YouTube channel of Echo of Moscow was to live for like the next 3 days only. And then they closed down the site with all the archives, including of course my program, the text transcripts and the videos, and some brave and knowledgeable people managed to extract some, I would say most, of these transcripts for me, because the program has been going on since September 2017. So it's now, it's now, by the way, 5 years we're to have celebrated the anniversary. But then by that time
great I had... Great anniversary.
Yes. By that time I had my own YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. So we continued this program while I was yet in Russia. And it's rather the pride of my life that we have not missed a Tuesday with my moving to Berlin. Mm-hmm. And it was on air already in the Bild studio that I announced that I'm now in Berlin. And that should have been, or I suspect it was a surprise to the audience, because last Tuesday I was in Russia having this program, and then next Tuesday I'm in Berlin, and so it went on week after week, except for a short break that we usually have in the summer. So it was a continuum that we tried to keep up. It was of psychological help to us, and also, I suppose, or I suspect, to the listeners as well.
To have your routines for yourself.
Yes.
Yeah, that was an interesting moment when we went out of the studio and Alexei Venediktov was sitting and giving the interview, and there were a lot of photographers, cameramen, and so on. And he said to Novaya Gazeta correspondent, Novaya Gazeta asked, how do you feel? And they said, I feel okay because they killed us. You are the next. Your position is much worse than mine. And that was really a feeling of something that something happened. We were waiting for that, of course. Mm-hmm. But it happened, and we need to live our life next. Yeah. And I should say that it was a feeling for me of a big adrenaline. Because you're feeling that you're doing something very, very important for those who are listening to us. Because usually people were listening to us on radio, but not on YouTube. On YouTube, we had approximately, usually we had 10 or maybe 20 thousands of views online. In the same moment. And when they switched off the radio, I just saw how it was growing from 20 to 30, from 30 to 40, from 40 to 80 and 100 viewers on YouTube. So, of course, when you see it and you know about all this historical moment, you don't think about your security, or you don't think about what will be with you, for me, for example, because adrenaline makes you do as you have to do.
Feeling like you have a big responsibility, I guess.
Yeah, the eyes of posterity and also the eyes of contemporaries are upon you. Yes, I understand the feeling.
So listening to your story, it sounds for me like you had not a second thinking about giving up, because you just continued 1 week later in a whole another country, in another city. Why did you never think about giving up?
Was it ever an option? Well, I can remember, not at that moment, but a bit later, in the end of spring, maybe beginning of summer of this year, when I had this notion that maybe it's not necessary any longer. It's not, we no longer have the audience that were out of the country, so we are possibly out of touch with what is happening. And my focus is always on interior politics, because that's what I do, that's what I study. And I can't suddenly switch to being a military expert or a foreign relations expert or whatever. And all the news around were news from Ukraine, of course, news from the front. And this is something I can have nothing to do with because I don't understand it. And I can't start educating myself because either I'm talking to people as an expert and then I keep to my field of expertise, or I stop doing it. So I had my moments of, I would say, my moments of weakness. But then you see the, well, the number of viewers and the number of views after after the show is over. Then you read the comments and then you kind of think that we better keep up. And since I think, well, it's not a very humane thing to notice, but still, when something bad happens, like the escalation of the war or mobilization or expectations of martial law or the martial law itself, you always have a jump up of views. And then you feel like you can't stop doing it, no matter how you feel personally, because you have to keep people informed. 60% of my audience now, not my audience, the audience of our program, is in Russia. So we could have the illusion that every one of our viewers have left, so they're now in Berlin or in Riga or in Vilnius or in Tbilisi, so what's the point? But no, we are still talking to people in Russia and they don't have many who can talk to them.
And why did you decide to come to Berlin? You just told me you speak French, you speak English, but of course you don't speak German, so it's a whole other country with a new language. What isn't really easy for journalists who work with their language?
For me, it was just a case, because when we were in this very bad for us week, when in Tuesday we were closed, I get a lot of different suggestions from all over the world. Like, hey, Maxim, don't stay in Russia, go out of Russia, and you can live in my flat, or I have a room, or I have a house somewhere, and so on. And some of these suggestions were from Britain, but I had no British visa. And I had a touristic visa to Germany, to European Union. And as far as I remember, that was suggestion to Екатерина Шульман, and you resent me the flat in Hanover.
Yeah.
And in Hanover, that somebody has a flat for 2 months, and if you want, you can come and live there. And it was March, and it was talks about mobilization at the time. And I thought,
and of course, about closing of borders.
Borders, and I'm an officer in reserve. So my choice was.
So you were in active service, actually.
No, I know. I was studying in special officer studying. I'm a military psychologist. Yeah, and I understood that I will go to the prison or I will go to the army. There is no other choice. Mm-hmm. And I decided to go out of Russia and use this suggestion to go to Hanover. Mm-hmm. And when I was going through all over the Europe and fighting, what Russian journalists, I came to Europe, what are they doing? At that time, the painter, Dmitry Vrubil, we were know each other. He was living in Berlin, and he asked me to come to Axel Springer because they want to ask some question about Russian media market and so on. And I was in Hanover. I came to Berlin, and we began to make this Built on Russian channel. And I had an opportunity to have a studio. At that time, I knew that Yekaterina has a Bosch Stiftung suggestion, and I understood, hey, that's wonderful. We can work in one yeah. city. We have a studio, and we have a staff which Bill gives us, so we can do it again.
Yeah.
Yes, that was a most fortunate coincidence. By the time you were traveling across Europe, we had a few programs, a few Tuesdays when I was in Moscow in the studio, and you were in like every hotel room on the continent. So we continued it this way. My story is that of much higher privilege and comfort than for many of my peers and colleagues. I had an offer of a Richard von Weizsäcker Fellowship from the Bosch Academy in March 2021. And this is a fellowship that you do not offer yourself to. It's not a grant. Mm-hmm. They invite you. It only comes by invitation. It's a highly prestigious fellowship. But in 2022, well, we started having a correspondence. And it went on and on. And then February happened, February 2022, and I understood that I need to accelerate the process. But it was a process already on the go. So it was not for me to search for options or to ask for whether anyone has a spare room. And I have a family of three children, so it's not that anyone can have enough room for such a crowd. But I already had this offer, this very kind offer. So we acted on it, and then the German embassy gave us a visa, and then we arrived in the beginning of April. And Maxim was already here, and this build studio was already in place, so I could actually make an announcement that, well, guys, now I'm working from Berlin for the next year. And on Friday, on the same week, I was declared a foreign agent by the Russian Ministry of Justice. Mm-hmm. That was also what one would call a fortunate coincidence, because as I knew later, as I discovered later from the documents that surfaced during various court cases, when I was suing the ministry, protesting against being declared a foreign agent. So I found out that they started writing to the Minister of Foreign Affairs, and those two ministers decided this thing together in March when I was still in the country. So it was not an ad hoc decision when they saw me on YouTube and said, oh, now she's there, now let's put her on the foreign agents list. So it was prepared beforehand. But then again, for the picture, it was pretty effective, yes.
Could you maybe explain that? What does it mean when they decline you as an agent?
That's complicated, as they write on status, relationship status on Facebook.
What does it mean for your What does it mean for your life, maybe?
It actually means a lot. I'm not. There are various types of foreign agents. Let's start with that. There are physical persons foreign agents, and there are physical persons acting as a media foreign agent. So I'm a media. I'm not just a person standing before you, I'm also an organization. Mm-hmm. I may not look like one, but I am. It's a status that is accorded to you by the Ministry of Justice. It's just like the fellowship you can offer yourself, you have to get invitation. You acquire various new responsibilities. For example, for every publication, for every bit of information that you publish, either on social media or in a magazine or in a newspaper, anywhere, you have to put an announcement that this message is created or published by a foreign agent or media acting as a foreign agent. It has to be in capital letters. It has to be either at the very beginning of the message or under the title.
So and there's no chance to reach new people who don't know you yet.
You
have that big label on yourself.
Certainly, well, first of all, it's humiliating and it's a lie.
Of course, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you need to wear this badge whether you want or not. Mm. Of course, it scares people off. Mm. It effectively prevents, yes, the extension of your audience, or it's meant to prevent it. Mm-hmm. But in reality, it doesn't happen quite like that. Sometimes it acts in the opposite direction, but still. For quite a time, it's effectively slowed down my social media activity, because it's such a nasty thing to do when you think I should post this or that, I should write about this, but then you remember that you need to put this thing.
Yeah, okay.
And then you think I wouldn't
bother.
Want
to just put a photo of a cat.
Yeah.
It's you can't do it without
an announcement.
Okay.
And whenever you are cited by anyone, they have to also to mention the fact of your being a foreign agent in brackets after your name.
And what would happen if you posted a picture of a cat without writing it?
You get fined. I did already. I have the first fine. Mm-hmm. At first, it's administrative responsibility. Second time, administrative responsibility. Third time, it's a criminal case. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's
to prison.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You can go to prison, you can get fined again, but for bigger sums. And what's worse, you can have your bank accounts arrested or your property seized. I don't have any property in Russia, fortunately. And my bank accounts are also of no use to or interest to anyone. Mm-hmm. But in order not to close for myself any opportunity of ever coming back, so I'm keeping with the law. So announcements are one thing. Four times a year, you report to the Ministry of Justice on the money you earn and the money you spend. And this is a very complicated form to fill, various forms, in fact. Once every half a year, you also report on what you've been doing, and then you have to publish this report.
Like really openly?
Yes, openly. You say, either you send it to some media or you publish it on your social media if you have one.
Okay.
So you need to tell the world what are you doing with all the money you are getting
from. All the money. Even if you are buying toilet paper or something like that, you should write it there.
Okay, so it's humiliating.
Yeah.
It's humiliating. It's quite a job. So you need to find time and resource to do it. Then you have to register a limited liability company in order to process these reports. And this is complicated because in order to register a limited liability company, you need to have somebody in the country. And usually if you are a foreign agent, you are not in the country. Or if you are in the country, you are most likely not free to register anything. But we, a group of foreign agents, managed to quite recently to register such an organization. Now I need to pay my share as a co-founder, and this also has to go through a particular bank. So again, it's quite a bit of a job. And of course, had I been in Russia, this would have effectively prevented me from being invited anywhere. I was a bit of a public speaker before the war. I used to have public lectures, I talked to corporations, et cetera, et cetera. On December the 1st of this year, a new version of the law will come into effect. And this also prohibits foreign agents from teaching at state or municipally owned universities, or and also prohibits them to deal with or create informational material for minors, people under 18. So I can't speak at a school, I can't write a children's book or a manual or whatever, because I'm a foreign agent. Luckily, I'm still not
so
forbidden from talking to my own children.
The radio station, actually.
Yes, that's a good comparison.
Okay.
Yes, so this is the status that, again, it's meant to effectively prevent your civic existence. So you can exist as a physical person, but you cannot as a public persona or as a teacher or an academician. Quite a lot of people with scientific degrees are foreign agents, and so there have already been examples of publications in the academic magazines with this with the mark under the title.
So maybe my last two questions, because you have an appointment, right? Can you speaking of that and telling me about your situation in Russia, is there any chance, maybe really naive question, that you can ever return to Russia?
Yes, of course, we will return, I believe.
I do, I'm sure about it, yes.
Why? Why are you so sure?
Because our work is there, our home is there, our audience is there, my potential students are there, my former students are all there. We are grateful for the opportunity to keep up with some parts of our work from a safer place, but of course we belong to Russia. These absurd regulations that I'm describing belong to the current phase of our political regime. On the next step, it will all fall apart and then disappear. And of course, we'll be happy to go back.
So when you talk about the current phase, maybe we have a look in the future. Talking about Russia, maybe in 10 years, what do you think, what kind of country could it be?
And that depends on us. The main reason for trying to return whenever there is the slightest opportunity is that you can't leave the country to the mercy of the ongoing barbarization. We were the, and I hope continue to be, most of all the public speakers. And I'm a teacher. So it's our duty to preserve and promote civilization. We can't allow a whole country to fall into the depth of barbarity. Now it is impossible to carry on the work because when you are there, you can talk. But when you're out of the country, you can talk, but you have much less influence. So that's the dilemma.
But I believe that we don't know how will Russia look like, but I believe it will be another. It will be other. It will be not as
The only thing we can be sure about is that the current phase is not permanent, or it won't even hold for longer. It can be, it can get worse. Things can always get worse. But the only thing we know about the present moment is that it's constantly evolving.
Do you have any hope for a positive change? Because it's a situation where it's really, really hard to have hope.
Well, the situation doesn't look good at the moment. Not at all. I do not have any immediate optimistic versions for the future. But then, basically, a country can't disappear. It's a big country with a lot of people. It's an urbanized, educated country where most of the population work not in agriculture or in industry, but in service sphere, in management, etc. So we have already been entering the post-industrial phase of development. Of course, you can go back. Political history and history in general knows examples of degradation when whole civilizations have reneged on their development. But again, a country can disappear. We have this impression that many people have left, but much more people have, of course, stayed. And among them, the educated people, the people with liberal and European values, they are not seen, their voice is not heard. They are in hiding, they are silent for self-evident reasons. That's why it seems that suddenly the whole country has turned around and transformed it into something quite different. But we have lived there, we have worked there. It's not like we've been inhabited a bubble. We are both not from Moscow. Mm. We are not the Moscow dwellers. And we do not come from very privileged environments. So we've been working in many places on various positions. So I don't think we've been feeding ourselves with illusions. And then, speaking of myself, I, as a social scientist, I have the data, mm-hmm. objective figures. So it is impossible to or suddenly decide that, well, let's give up on this miserable country. Nothing much will happen there. So what will it do? It will do something. So whenever there's an opportunity, we need to influence this development in the way which seems to us to be right or degrade.
Very famous phrase in Russian free journalism: I will never humiliate myself by a hope. It means that we just don't need to hope. We need to do something to save someone who can be saved in this situation. And that was Ekaterina said about, we don't know what how will Russia look like, and we even don't know will be Russia after 10 years, to tell the truth. That would be a very difficult period of our lives and our country life. That's, I understand. So hope is not the really right word, mm-hmm. because even if the regime will change and so on, and we will come back to Russia. That would be very hard years for Russia and for us.
Thank you very much for the interview.